I'm going to start with a fun trivia and a short experiment. On your two screens, you see a picture of a beautiful house. And I'd like to know from the audience if you can tell me who actually lives in this house. Anyone? It's not a trick question. It's not an optical illusion. Just say it. An actor. Okay. In a moment, I'll reveal to you who actually stays in this house. But from my experience of facilitating this with audiences around the world, I have noticed two things. Normally, no two responses are same. Second, the responses are generally never right, okay? The range of responses that I typically hear when I show this is from everything from this could be a house of a politician, this could be a house of a Bollywood star, a Hollywood star, a designer, a surfer, a business tycoon, and you name it, and the list goes on. So what just happened? You saw a piece of data, yet we all arrived at slightly different conclusions. How is that that has happened? This is a simple experiment or an illustration of how our minds are at work when you think about how we perceive things and how we make decisions based on our perception. Now in this particular instance, when I showed you this house, the different responses are actually triggered by the fact of different mental models that we carry. The mental model is nothing but how we see the world, how our lives are shaped, right? It's a function of our education, our childhood, our schooling, our friends at social network, right? The colleagues at work. And in this particular instance, what happened is that when I showed you a piece of data, you looked at a partial piece of data, you selected a piece of data, and then you attached a meaning to it based on your past experience, right? And then from that, that perhaps became part of your belief system from which you drive your next decision. So typically when I show this and I say that, okay, how is it that you tell me a trader, people look at that clock and say that because there are two clocks, the person could be in two time zones and maybe that's why there's a trader in this house. Or they look at this beautiful furniture and they actually say that this could be a house of an art collector, but with a house with no young kids. Or they tell me that this is so neat and clean that only a lady could have this house, no guy could keep it this clean. What you saw, what psychologists call, is a perception bias. Perception bias is something that happens to us much more than we realize. It happens in the organizations, it happens also in our personal lives. Organizations have a perception of how they wish to run their companies. There are some organizations, they perceive that to be dominating, very aggressive culture is the key to success. There are other organizations who believe that it's probably good to be a team player and allow the individual identities to shine, and that's their culture. Individually, we do perception tests all the time. We see a certain first name, we perceive, and then we decide. We see a person dressed a certain way, we perceive, and then we decide. These perception bias distorts the way we think. And there are many such biases that come into our thinking which distorts our decision-making process. So what I'm going to talk about today is some of the key biases. Which are the biases that come into our play and how we can overcome them? And how we can stop these biases from making sure that our decision is somewhat rational. It's a great pleasure to be here. My name is Nikhil to the TEDx Forum. I've been in the leadership and the talent development space for more than two decades, and I've had the chance to work with some of the most senior executives around the world. If you think about what makes a good leader today, the list is quite long. You'll hear terms like you need IQ, you need EQ, you need value quotient, you need to have the ability to manage millennials, a lot of you here. You need to make sure that you're tech savvy, you're digitally savvy, strategic thinking, all these buzzwords. But if there's one thing that stands out when you think about these successful leaders is the clarity of decisions and the clarity of the decisions and make sure that how bold they are taking decisions. Now, we've all seen these people. These people are there at work. These people are also there at our personal lives. At work, these are the people who make sure that they take the bold decisions to launch a product, to launch a brand. At work, these are the people who make the decisions to make sure that they hit their financial goals, their health goals, their relationship goals. As human beings, we're perhaps the most powerful species because we have the power to choose. Decision making by in itself is not very complicated. You have a problem on hand, you look at the alternatives, you analyze the alternatives, and you get a solution. Yet, we find that we get it wrong so often. Raise your hand if you think you've ever made a bad decision in your life. All right, just about everybody in this room, right? He's the exception. Now, when you think about bad decisions, the research normally points to two things. First of all, there could be a lack of process, which means that we haven't looked at the data properly. We haven't analyzed all the options. We haven't looked at the cost-benefit analysis. But more often than not, it's not the process, but it's actually the mind of the decision maker. How our brain can sabotage the way we think distorts the decision-making process. So today, I'm going to focus on three key biases. There are hundreds of these biases. I'm going to focus on three biases and how they distort our thinking. Now, before I do that, I want to spend some time first helping you understand how does our brain actually make decisions. So if you think about our brain, there are three key components. There is a brainstem, limbic system, and the neocortex. The brainstem is essentially responsible for keeping us alive, hunger, temperature control, the balance, and we largely don't realize this. The second is the limbic system. The limbic system is essentially responsible for our emotions, okay? The fight or the flight response that we normally get when we encounter an external stimuli, that's all done by the limbic system. And the neocortex is actually the part of the brain which actually does the sensory computation and the higher order decision making. Now, as human beings, we actually get thousands of external stimuli coming to us every single day. Right, so our brain processes these decisions and then we in a form of a response. We have hundreds and millions of neurons in our brain which actually create a pattern of the world that we see. Okay, so every decision that we do is creating a pattern in the brain. So the big question when it comes to decision making is very simply, are we making rational decisions? Okay, as human beings, do we think we're making rational decisions? Now, there is a hypothesis that we should make rational decisions for the simple fact that there are all these theories which say that logically we should be making rational decisions. So if you want to know the truth, there is the theory of logic. If you want to know with numbers and statistics, there's probability and statistics. Yet, we do not make the most rational decisions. Somewhere there is a gap of how we should make decisions and how we actually make decisions. What is happening is that there is so much data coming to us so fast that our brain only looks at part of the data that is relevant to us. Okay, we come up with a quick shortcut, which is called a bias, and then we make two decisions. Now, there are two important things here. Number one, when we're making a shortcut in a decision making, this is happening at a subconscious level. We're not even aware of it that we're doing it. Number two, when we're doing this decision, you have to be careful that we think that this is a right decision. In many occasions, it could be a right decision, but sometimes when the information is very complicated, you do not have all the data, when the risk is very high, it may not be the best decision. Daniel Kahneman, who was the Nobel-winning psychologist who did the work on biases, actually says that our brain has two operating systems. There's system one and there's system two. System one is the part of the brain which is actually responsible for fast, intuitive decision making. This is when our biases come in. System two, on the other hand, is supposed to be the slower, analytical, reflective system, which actually acts as an oversight to system one. I'm going to do a quick experiment right now just to prove that the bias is actually kicking, all right? Let's do this. On your screen, you see 10 words. I'm going to give you 5 seconds to quickly remember these 10 words, all right? Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. Raise your hand if you got slumber. Raise your hand if you got bed. Raise your hand if you got pajamas. Raise your hand if you got dream. Raise your hand if you got sleep. Ah, sleep wasn't there, okay? Sleep was just the way your mind just tricked you, okay? So the 9 words that you saw were related to sleep, but they weren't actually, it wasn't sleep, okay? So, let's move on. These are the 10 words. Now, let's talk about the biases. Raise your hand if you've ever been to a bad movie. Has anyone been to a bad movie? Yes, we all have been to a bad movie. All right. Normally when you have a bad movie, some of us are brave enough to actually leave the theater, right? But for the most of us, what happens? We're wrestling with this thought that, well, actually, should I or should I not go? I've already paid the 300 rupees. I've driven 5 kilometers. I've had the popcorn. I might as well stick it out, right? How bad can that be? Now, if you think about logically, when you think about the 300 rupees is already spent, if it's a good movie or not, it's not coming back. But if it's a bad movie, what happens? Not only do you lose 300 rupees, but you also lose another precious 90 minutes of your life. But we never think it like that. As human beings, we have a huge aversion to loss, so we want to protect that, right? And we see that in all aspects of life. For example, when you see in sports, right, you have a team owner who has actually bought a very expensive player, and he's not in good form, yet he's feeling compelled that you want to put him out there in the field just because you spend a lot of money on it, right? When in fact you could have a younger player who's really in good form, but the owner doesn't do that because he's already put money in it. We see governments do that when they're engaged in war and they just stick it out. This is what we call as a sunk cost bias. The sunk cost bias is our ability to justify the decisions of the past when they're no longer relevant today, all right? Now, I'm gonna tell you a story. About 5 years ago, we worked with a client where we met this general manager, and they were lending money, and they were actually lending money to the King of Good Times. Now, we all know the King of Good Times is really not having a good time now, but he was the first one to tell us that, you know, he's the King of Bad Times. And I said, why? And then he explained to us how he was over-leveraged. Now, over the period of these 5 years, we had about four other general managers who actually were lending money to Mr. Malia. And what we found out is that they continued doing that. So halfway through this project, I asked the gentleman, I said, look, why are you still doing this? And he said two things. He said, Nikhil, number one, in our system, if we raise our hand when there's something going wrong, we become the black sheep. Okay. Number two, what happens is that we still believe that he's going to come through. We all know what's happened, right? He's struggling. Now, juxtapose that to another client story we had about 3-4 years ago. This is a large conglomerate, the top five firms of our country. They went to venture into organized retail business. We all know organized retail is a very tough business. You have issues with supply chain, working capital, hiring talent, acquisition of land. About 3 years into it, they couldn't scale up. They took the call, we're going to abort. Okay, there was nothing against the management. They simply took a call and they said, we're going to abort. So you have two examples, one where the sunk cost was actually happening, another example where they didn't allow the sunk cost to come in. Now, how do you overcome the sunk cost? When you encounter sunk cost, you want to ensure first you recognize it. Make sure you see someone, you stop them doing that. Number two, do not create this fear of failure culture. Google did a study of 180 teams for 5 years, and they found out the world's best performing teams, okay, and how they make the best decision is not the IQ or the team chemistry, it's having the psychological safety. So if you've done a mistake, admit it and move on, all right? All right, we live in a time when there's so much data coming to us. We're drowned with data, okay? One of our most dangerous biases is to look for data that supports our belief. So for example, if you think that 8 glasses of water is the right amount of water, you will go on Google and look for data that supports that. If you think that the stock market's gonna go up, you're gonna look for that data. There are people who believe that stock market is gonna go down, they're gonna look for that data, irrespective of what's happening in the stock market. And that's why you see the bulls always remaining bulls, the bears remaining bears. If you think that allopathic is better than homeopathic, you're gonna look for that kind of data. Now, this year, earlier in May, my wife and I were quite stressed as parents because we had a young son who was appearing for his board exams. And we know in the Indian education system, we expect all clarity of life to come at the age of 15. So anyway, the first anxiety, the hurdle was jumped when we got the results. The results were very good. So in fact, they were excellent. And so that was done. Then came the next question, which stream should he choose? So as a good parent, the two of us, we said, well, let's have him talk to a few successful people in our network, in the professional network, in our family, and see, you know, if we can make a proper decision. So starting with my father, who is an arts major, he spoke to my father, very successful guy, he's traveled 75, 80 countries. In our family, we have an uncle who's a doctor, a brain surgeon, another uncle who's been a CEO of a couple of large companies. Commerce, my brother, my cousins, everyone, they've got successful entrepreneurs. So anyway, he's speaking to all these people, and we find out that at the end of these conversations, he's actually becoming more confused. And so we were wondering what to do. What else can we do? And so therefore, we have him talk to the principal, and the principal then actually said that perhaps he's only seeing one side of the data. He's not really seeing everything else. And I said, well, what do you mean? So then she said that, look, you think about engineers as a profession. We have great stories, but remember, In India, we pride ourselves to say we make more engineers than US and China, but how many of our engineers are actually employable? Okay, that's a big question. Number two, if you want to pursue a career in medicine, today it's the time of super specialty, right? You have 4 years of education, another 3 years for MD, another 3 years for super specialty. You're looking at 11 years of education after 12, okay? We also know these pass-out ratios for streams like commerce. So the moment my son saw some of this, it actually was bringing more clarity to him, okay? Because he was tossing between science and commerce. He wanted to be an entrepreneur. He also had a liking for science. But some of this data was giving him a bit of clarity that, okay, maybe I don't have the appetite to go all the 12 years to become a doctor. Now, the intent of this is not to discourage a child. The intent of this is to help you see the two sides of the data, right? And if you don't do that, what happens is that you could be lulled into an overconfidence bias. And if you don't, then you could be into a survivorship bias, right? So how do you overcome the confirmation bias? The best thing to do for overcoming the confirmation bias is simply look for contradicting data. Elon Musk, the successful entrepreneur, says, I do not want to talk to people who are simply agreeing with me. I want to talk to people who have a different point of view. Okay? Some of the most successful PE firms in the world, they actually invest in projects when they hear both sides of the story. Okay? It's not just saying that it's lucrative. I want to hear the good and I want to hear the bad. All right. For my final bias, I'm going to actually give you a math trivia for all the math wizards out there. Can anybody help me solve 8 times 7 times 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1? Do not use the calculator. Do not use your cell phones. All right. To make it easy, I've actually given you two choices. There is 1,000 and 2,000. Raise your hand if you think the answer is closer to 1,000. Raise your hand if you think the answer is closer to 2,000. All right? Okay? On an average, when I've done this experiment, people tell me the answer is 2250. Okay? I'm going to give you a slightly easier problem. This is 1 times, 2 times, 3 times, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Again, to make it easy for you, I'm giving you two choices. Raise your hand if you think the answer is closer to 500. How many think it's closer to 500? Okay, 3, 4. How many think it's actually closer to 1,000? All right, half of you. Again, in this experiment, I found that it's actually 512. Now, the funny thing is both of these are wrong. The actual answer is 40,320. You were off by a factor of 10. Look at it very closely. The problem is also flipped. The same question is asked in a different way. So what just happened? This is what we call an anchoring bias. Our brain gets anchored to the data that's put up to us up front. In this particular instance, the time that we took to guesstimate is what is called anchoring. The problem is our brain doesn't anchor far enough, and that's the bias. So, we see the anchoring bias play out all the time in our lives, right? For example, when the government tells us they're going to raise the petrol price by 4.5 rupees, what are we doing? We're expecting 4.5 rupees, but then they very cleverly only do 2 rupees. Okay, so we actually feel it's not a bad deal. 4.5, 2 rupees. Okay, because our brain is already anchored at 4.5. And when we get 2, we actually feel we got a good deal. Okay, so how do you overcome anchoring? Anchoring, if you're on the selling side, if you're a negotiator, it's best to put a high figure up front. You can use anchoring to your advantage. Okay, if you're on the buying side, question the assumptions. Have a wider frame of looking at the data. Okay, and if you're going fresh into any new situation, you want to make sure that you do not put any anchors at all. All right? Now, to summarize, I'm going to say we covered 3 biases, the sunk cost bias, the confirmation bias, and the anchoring bias. There are hundreds of these biases. Do remember, whether it's a personal decision or a business decision, our brains are continuously working, sometimes in ways we don't know. So the more complex the situation, the more assumptions that we're making. The more people we're involved, the more biases that are involved. Okay. Finally, I'm going to leave you with 3 more tips to how do you de-bias. About 2 years ago, I met the CEO of a large financial services company. Their senior leadership team was not able to make a good decision. So the first thing he wanted to change in the entire system was to institutionalize the decision-making muscle. He wanted to create a good decision-making skill in the entire organization. So the first step was to make people self-aware of what these biases are. Okay? So the one thing that we did is that we printed 10 or 15 of these biases and we circulate it across the organization. So every person in the company needs to know what the biases are and how they work. So that was step one. So when you want to de-bias, make sure that you're self-aware. Number two, there's this concept of decision diary. It sounds a little strange, but it's actually quite effective. The decision diary is simply saying that when you're taking key decisions, whether it's short-term decisions or long-term decisions, get into a habit of writing those decisions. Make the assumption that you're putting when you're taking decisions and the outcome you were expecting. After a while, you can go back and look at it, and you'll be surprised to see there's a pattern of biases that you normally always do. Okay, so again, it's a muscle. You have to practice. Companies who've used this method have actually found that their decision-making skills over a period of time improve. Lastly, I will say, slow down. Make sure that you activate your system to thinking, reflective thinking. And that's what is very important when you get into a very complex situation. In the end, I'm going to leave you with this very good quote from Soren Kierkegaard, who says that life can only be understood backwards, but it must be lived forwards. Okay, there is a saying that says we make good decisions, good decisions come from experience, but experience comes from bad decisions. So today I have given you three simple tools, three biases from which hopefully you can learn and make better decisions. I wish you good luck. Thank you.